Brand new intermittent fasting study just came out, and these always cause a big hoopla. Intermittent fasting is the practice of restricting eating to specific time windows. One of the most popular types is called 16-8, where you eat in an 8-hour window every day, for example, from 7 a.m. to 3 p.m., and you fast for the other 16 hours of the day. And no, eating 16 hours and fasting 8 hours while you're asleep doesn't count. I checked. Damn it. Now, fasting involves two different factors, so this can get a little confusing. First, not eating for blocks of time can help reduce total calories, as long as I don't completely compensate during the eating window. And second, depending what time of day we eat, there may be a circadian effect, so that eating the same food at different times may have a different physiological impact. Specifically, eating earlier in the day, in the morning and early afternoon, seems physiologically better in several studies than eating later in the day and at night. So the new trial looks at exactly this, 16-8 done early in the day, in the morning and early afternoon. Now there's a few ways that we can study 16-8 and ask this question. We can ask if eating earlier in the day without changing anything else, without cutting calories, has a benefit. Or you can ask if 16-8 gives you an additional benefit on top of restricting calories. So those are slightly different questions. And this current trial looked at that second one, 16-8 on top of cutting calories. They took 90 volunteers, all obese, and they had everybody restrict calories for 14 weeks. And they ate roughly 500 calories less than before the trial, per day. And then they had half of the volunteers eat their food only during an 8-hour window early in the day, from 7 a.m. to 3 p.m. The other half ate in a wider window of 12 or more hours, starting at the same time, 7 a.m., but continuing all the way to 7 p.m. or later. So what they were shooting for with the trial was to have both groups eat the same food, same calories, but at different times. One group concentrated more in the morning, and the other spaced out over the course of the day. Okay, so what did they find? Both groups lost weight. Not surprising, they were both cutting calories. But the group on 16-8 lost more, 50% more. The controls lost 4 kilos, about 9 pounds, and those on 16-8 lost 6.3 kilos. Okay, so that means fasting wins, right? Not so fast. Get it? Fast? Sorry. We have to be careful when we talk about weight loss. We can lose weight by losing muscle. Nobody wants that. What we want is to lose extra fat. And both groups lost fat. And in the 16-8 group, there was a trend towards losing more fat. It wasn't statistically significant looking at all the participants, but when they looked just at the completers, just the ones that finished the trial, it was statistically significant. The controls lost 3.4 kilos of fat, and the 16-8 group lost 5.2. So it does look like 16-8 helped them lose a bit more fat. And remember, this was only 14 weeks. If it was a longer trial, we might see a bigger difference. Okay, great. But we all know that health is about a lot more than just losing weight or even losing fat. So did 16-8 deliver any other benefits? The 16-8 group also had lower diastolic blood pressure by the end of the trial and better mood. They reported feeling significantly less tired and less depressed than the controls. Other physiological parameters were not significantly different between the two groups. Heart rate, glucose levels, insulin, insulin resistance, cholesterol, or triglycerides. Now, one objection that a lot of people raise to this scheme of eating earlier in the day is the social aspect. It doesn't allow you to have dinner with your family or with friends, so it limits you socially, and a lot of people don't like that. Although, this is really interesting, 41% of the completers in the 16-8 group reported that they plan to continue with 16-8 early in the day after the study. So some people don't like it, some people are fine with it. It's basically a personal choice, kind of a no-brainer. Now, one note of uncertainty in this study is that when I look at the numbers, the caloric intake of the two groups is not statistically significantly different between the two. They were both cutting calories, both eating less than before the trial, but between the two, there doesn't seem to be a significant difference. And yet, the authors say that they suspect the 16-8 group did reduce energy intake more. And there was actually a podcast released with the editor of the journal, and the lead author of the study reiterated that they think there might be a stronger caloric deficit in the 16-8 group.
We started to do some further analyses. We don't see that participants who are practicing the early time restricted eating are eating fewer meals, but we do see some evidence that they are potentially eating less.
So it's not entirely clear if the extra benefits that we're seeing are due to them eating a little bit less calories or not. For some people, this might not matter much where exactly the benefit is coming from, as long as they can get it by doing 16-8. On the other hand, it is of biological and medical interest if there's a special added benefit of this circadian effect that we can't get just by keeping calories reasonable. And the authors themselves don't seem very convinced that this trial answers that question. Extra benefits, yes, those were reported. Where are they coming from exactly? Not entirely clear, at least for now. Okay, so where does the study fall in the general context of all of the evidence of this field? It's interesting that a couple months ago, there was another study out on intermittent fasting done in China that also made all the headlines. And they had an identical design to this one. 16-8, also on top of calorie restriction, also early in the day, and they reported no added benefit of 16-8. Back then, we made a video talking about that trial. This was back in April. And my conclusion, if you look at that video, was that 16-8 might still have an effect. Now, why would I say that when talking about a trial that reported no significant benefit? Well, it's because the balance of evidence suggested it. Other trials that already existed in the literature pointed to that possibility. Boy, am I glad that I didn't just extrapolate from the findings of that one study in isolation, right? Here we are a couple months later, new study, identical design, and it suggests that 16-8 does have an effect. So this is why it's crucial, and I insist on all the videos, that we take a look at the general landscape of the field, not just one study in a vacuum. Otherwise, we get whiplash from study to study and we don't know what to think. And that's actually what happened with the headlines a little bit. With the April trial from China, they wrote that this protocol of 16-8 done earlier in the day provides no benefit. And this week, looking at the new trial, the headlines basically say that 16-8 bolsters weight loss. It's not that the headlines are wrong because they're referring to each study in isolation. And I'm not trying to bash the journalists. It's just that the public is going to get lost with this. Well, does it work or not? Scientists can't agree, blah, blah, right? Okay, so why did the two trials find different results? Two main possibilities. One, the April trial from China was more effective with weight loss in general. All the participants lost more weight than in this recent trial. So maybe that more dramatic weight loss masked the effect of 16-8. Possible. Another possibility is that in the older trial from China, the eating window of the controls wasn't that much longer than the group on 16-8. It was about 2 hours longer, give or take. But in the new trial, the eating window of the controls was almost 5 hours longer than the people doing 16-8. So it's possible that you need a certain minimum contrast between the groups to pick up a difference. And that would make sense. So these are just possibilities. So if this is true, it means that if I normally eat in a 10-hour window, I'm not going to benefit much by going to 8. But if I eat in a 14 or 15-hour window, I might. So the bottom line from all of this is that 16-8, or really any type of fasting, can help us control calories, at least in some contexts. And then on top of that, there might be a circadian effect. Not entirely clear, but I don't think it's been ruled out. All right, now, every time we make a video on intermittent fasting, viewers always ask the same question. What about autophagy? Even in videos where we talk about autophagy, there's usually complaints that we didn't talk enough about autophagy. So my friends, today we are talking about autophagy. Okay, what is autophagy? Auto means self and phagy means eat. So autophagy is essentially self-eating. It's a process of self-cannibalism inside ourselves that removes damaged components. So it's kind of like the housekeeping and the renovation of the cell. Now, in mice, the benefits of fasting depend on autophagy. If you inhibit autophagy, the benefits are lost. So that's a really interesting result, but we have to be careful with the logical leap to humans and starting claiming that everybody needs to be fasting because of the amazing benefits of autophagy. This type of thing sounds great because it's science-y, contains some buzzwords, and it's new, or at least it was when people started saying it. But when we look at the actual evidence, it's a lot more sobering. First of all, several things activate autophagy. Fasting does. Exercise also does. Just eating less calories does. Even oxidative stress activates autophagy. So it's not something proprietary to fasting. Also, it's not as simple as just autophagy good, so let's just crank it up. It is true that autophagy is thought to play many beneficial roles, but in some diseases, autophagy may have both beneficial and harmful effects, depending on context. Now, this video is mainly centered on the new trial that just came out. I don't want to make an unwatchable 2-hour video, but if there's interest, we can totally make videos dedicated to the effect of fasting on specific diseases, cancer, neurodegeneration, etc. And as always, I'm mainly going to be interested in clinical data. We can look at data in animals and in vitro, but at the end of the day, we want to see what the data in humans, the clinical data, says. And that's essentially the bottom line. We want to base our decisions, our behaviors, on demonstrated health effects in living, breathing humans. Molecular data always sounds sexy, but unless there's a lot of evidence of actual health effects in humans, chasing these mechanisms can be a wild goose chase. Sometimes it can even be harmful. Sometimes it is justified. Avoiding very high blood glucose levels is a good idea because there's a lot of evidence that that can lead to nasty effects in the long run. But for something like autophagy, it's nowhere near as clear. So it's not bad to keep in mind that we only care about these molecular events to the extent that they result in us feeling better sooner or later. So we should decide to exercise, for example, because of the many demonstrated health effects, whether those work through autophagy or not. As for fasting, it's a valid way to control calories, works for some people. We have a number of viewers who like it. And eating earlier in the day may or may not have an additional circadian effect independent from calories. TBD. Whether you choose to fast or not, do 16-8 or not, the bulk of your benefits are likely going to come from the fundamentals. And when it comes to nutrition, that's mainly two things: food quality and keeping total calories reasonable. Whatever strategy helps you achieve that, whether it's a low-fat diet, low-carb, fasting, or just being criterious about which foods you prioritize, that's your ticket. Here's that previous video on 16-8, and here's a comparison between keto and Mediterranean, and what I mean exactly by food quality. See you there.